John, welcome, welcome.
Hi, Barbara. Hi, Harriet. Lots of familiar faces. Hello.
It is getting nice and warm out. It is, what is it, May? What's the date?
May 24th.
Oh, it was nice out today. A little warmer, you know, a little warmer, but it was beautiful. Actually, kind of cool. I actually did a run outside today, so it was fun.
Yeah.
So we have a wonderful show in store for you tonight. I'm excited about our guest this evening. I'm excited about all of our guests, of course. But this guest, I have some familiarity with some of the projects he's been working on. So, like, this man is too hot to handle.
Yeah, we're looking forward to hearing from him, what he has going on, and just a little bit about how he came to be who he is. I love hearing that the most about the artist that we have on Mondays with Mooch, who inspired them when they were young, and just about their experiences. I think it's such a cool way to see a little bit kind of, I guess, behind the curtain or backstage into the lives of these artists. So
it is.
Looking forward to learning.
And one thing that I've noticed as the theme, I look back at all the shows, but most of them started when they were super young. They knew, like, when they were like 9 or 10 or 12, you know, I'm gonna do this, and they stuck with it. So that's pretty powerful.
Absolutely. Are we ready to let the show begin, Joe? Looks like it.
And away we go.
The year was 1900, the dawning of a new century. The United States Census estimates the country's population to be about 70 million people. That year, Puccini's opera Tosca premiered in Rome. The World's Fair opened in Paris, and the Second Olympic Games was held simultaneously in the same city. American temperance agitator Carrie Nation begins her crusade to demolish saloons. And Milton Snavely Hershey, working from his Lancaster, PA Carmel Company, introduced the world's first milk chocolate Hershey bar, more sustaining than meat. It was that year, in a small New Jersey town called Red Bank, named after the rich red clay found on the banks of the Navesink River, it was that year that an 18-year-old African-American lad named Harvey, hailing from Mecklenburg, Virginia, married his high school sweetheart, Lillian Childs. Harvey worked as a coachman and a caretaker for a wealthy local judge. Later, when automobiles replaced horses, he became a groundskeeper and handyman for several wealthy families in the area. He was a well-respected man in his community, and he was soon elected to be church advisor and a trustee to the newly formed Pilgrim Baptist Church in Red Bank. Harvey and Lillian were both musically inclined. He played the mellophone, she played the piano. Lillian took in laundry and baked cakes for a living, and subsequently gave birth to two sons, Leroy and William James. Sadly, Leroy died of meningitis at an early age, but Lillian would eventually give William his first piano lessons, until he showed such an interest that she ended up paying 25 cents a lesson to Miss Grace Malcho for more formal instruction. William showed such promise and dedication to the piano that he went on to carve out a nice living for himself. We think his professional career began as he won $2.50 in gold in a piano playing contest in Asbury Park. You see, his father's full name was Harvey Lee Basie, and for William, we now know him as the Count, William James Count Basie. That Pilgrim Baptist Church is still a major presence in the community, and that band that William formed, the Count Basie Orchestra, is still touring and recording to this day. Back in the early part of the century, in some circles, not much was thought of jazz music. It was a fad and would soon fade away, they thought. The renowned and very popular wind band leader Arthur Pryor spent many, many summers presenting daily concerts at the 8th Avenue Pavilion in Asbury Park to hordes of summer vacationers. Pryor didn't have much to say about this music that was already taking over the airwaves and attracting all the young music lovers. "Jazz is a parasite of music," he said. And sort of with a backhanded softening, he said, "Jazz is a splendid thing for those who want to dance. It gives them great pleasure. Yet, there is no originality in it except the rhythm, and it means nothing outside of its pleasure on the dance floor." Well, Count Basie had an answer to that. He said, "If you play a tune and a person don't tap their feet, don't play the tune." When you use the Google machine to find out what's the oldest and longest running bands, you get these answers. The Beach Boys, 1961. The Rolling Stones, 1962. The Who, 1964. And ZZ Top, 1969. Well, I say pshaw. Yeah, that's a real word. I looked it up. Consider that we have even the longest running jazz club opened in 1953, the Deerhead Inn. And more importantly, the Count Basie Orchestra, which was formed in 1935, is still touring today. In fact, in the history of jazz music, there's only one band leader that has the distinction of having his orchestra still performing sold-out concerts all over the world for over 30 years after his passing. Pianist and band leader Count Basie was and still is an American institution that personifies the grandeur and excellence of jazz. The Count Basie Orchestra, today directed by Scotty Bernhardt, has won every respected jazz poll in the world, at least once, won 18 Grammy Awards, performed for kings, queens, and other royalty, appeared in several movies, television shows, at every major jazz festival and major concert hall in the world. As our guest today will tell you, to tour with that band is an incredible experience. It was always known as the most swinging big band ever, and to have the opportunity to sit in that band and learn from the depth of knowledge and traditions is quite remarkable. In addition to touring with the Basie Band, our guest Shawn Edmonds is a multifaceted artist whose expertise crosses the genres of jazz, classical, and commercial music. And a career like that as a freelance musician opens up a worldview that is rich in culture and experiences that most people never get to have. You get to travel the world. You also get to dress up, share great meals. Well, sometimes you have to play in the supermarket for your groceries. But you meet a lot of girls, and you never know who you'll meet along the way. Shawn Edmonds made his solo debut in 1982 after winning the Chicago Symphony Orchestra's Young Artist Solo Competition. Upon graduating the Eastman School of Music, he moved to New York City, where he began his tenure and featured soloists with the Count Basie Orchestra. In addition to tours with the Basie Band, Shawn had a busy career as a freelance musician in New York City and has appeared with the Queen Symphony, Westchester Philharmonic, the Beirut Philharmonic Pops Orchestra, and the Duke Ellington Big Band, as well as stints backing up artists like Bette Midler and playing lead trumpet with Aretha Franklin. I'm sure our friend Bernie Purdy was with him on that one. Shawn has also given masterclasses and appearances as a visiting clinician and soloist at universities all around the world. More recently, he was principal trumpet for the Emmy Award-winning production of Jesus Christ Superstar, live on NBC, featuring John Legend and Alice Cooper. This Emmy win accompanies his 1998 Grammy win with the Count Basie Orchestra for the CD Count Plays Duke. Folks, please welcome my friend, Shawn Edmonds. How are you?
Good, Mooch. How you doing, man?
I'm doing good. I'm doing good. More importantly, how are you feeling?
I'm feeling better, man. You know, I had a little scare there, but I'm back and eating right, and everything will be cool.
That's great. Good to hear, man.
Yeah.
So, quite a career.
Yeah.
Yeah. I never thought I'd have this career that I did, you know.
And it's still going.
Yeah, really. Wow.
Well, yeah. As soon as we open up, it'll still be gone, I suppose.
Yeah. Things are starting to come back. I mean, I've gotten calls for quite a few gigs that I thought.
Do you actually have things in your calendar?
Yep. Yeah. Last week I was with Basie and at Auburn University, and I was supposed to be with the Queen Symphony over the weekend. But you know what happened with that.
Yeah.
I'm supposed to do a remake of Jersey Boys this summer for a couple of months. So, yeah.
That on Broadway? No.
No, they're doing a remake of that movie that they did.
The movie.
Yeah, that was like maybe 10, 15 years ago.
Wow, so soon.
Yeah. So
why not? If it'll make a buck, why not remake it?
Fall, right?
Yeah, right.
Sorry, what'd you say, Carmen?
I said you'll be going back to Broadway this fall?
Our show has an October 16th opening, and they're already selling tickets.
Okay.
So, we're really excited about that.
That's Ain't Too Proud to Beg, story about the Temptations, correct?
Exactly. And the show was a hit when we closed.
Yeah. You know,
our numbers were good, so, I think it'll come back strong, you know.
The writer Dominique Morisseau, did she write that one?
Yeah. Okay. Harold Wheeler did the music, and Kenny Seymour did the arrangements. So, yeah.
Well, I'll just say, just to give a plug, but she's a great writer. So I'm imagining this is a phenomenal show. So I would look forward to seeing that show myself. So
it is. I mean, people are dancing in the aisles every night, and there was even a guy in the audience clapping with a red hat on. I won't.
Oh, really?
I won't go any farther with that, but you know what I mean.
Yeah, let's not. Yeah. Right.
And you also
Go ahead, Carmen. What?
Sorry, you did Motown as well? You worked on that show as well?
Yeah, I subbed on that show. Yeah.
Okay, great.
You know, we had a chat a little earlier in the day about we kind of have similar origins in that we were classical musicians. And you still like do classical gigs here and there, right?
Yeah, I do.
That's a quite a different thing.
Altogether. And you know, you get caught out there sometimes because you get called for a gig, you know, and I'd be on tour with like the Basie band and have like maybe 3 days between getting home and the job, and it's like, okay, I gotta get my C trumpet chops back together and get my articulation back together and my sound, because
your piccolo trumpet chops.
Yeah, you dig? You know.
I do dig. And here I wanna play something that I came across. And I want you to check this out. There you go.
Where was that from? What was that nice solo there?
Yeah, a little history on that. That was like spur of the moment, like, okay, I got to do this. I've been in school for the last 8 years trying to get a doctorate. And they're finally giving me the boot in December. They're like, look, you know, glad you're working, but, you know, got to get you out of here. So my deadline is December, you know. But I've been applying for a lot of college jobs, especially during COVID. And, being on tour a lot, you don't get called to play a Haydn trumpet concerto, anywhere. So, and that's what they're looking for. They're like, well, can you send us a recent recording of you playing the Haydn or the Hummel? It's like, I can send you a recording of me playing at Carnegie Hall with Nancy Wilson, but I don't, so I just basically decided, okay, I can rent the hall out where I'm in school and just go with my little Zoom camera and make some perfunctory recordings, which that's what that was. That was like a day's notice, so that I'd have something to send around to these schools.
Sounded great. Sounded just great.
Yeah.
Well, good luck with that. And sooner or later, we're going to end up calling you Dr. Sean.
Well, in December, hopefully,
There you go.
I'll make it.
So now, when did I was Jacqueline, who is our Zoom operator and team member. We were talking earlier about how we really enjoy the origin stories of the musicians that we get to meet and on in this program. So we're just curious in terms of you started out in Chicago. Is that where you're from?
No, that's where I ended up. That's where I spent the second part of my life.
Okay. So where were you born and you're
Yeah, I mean, my story is very interesting. It's kind of bittersweet talking about it, especially since I went home last week. I was born in 1965, in Georgia. So, don't have to really go into what that was about back then. It was segregated and until, let's see, 1981 is when they finally integrated that little town of Midville that I was in. But the school that the black kids went to, there were 8 rooms for grades 1 through 8. There were no sports programs, no music. We would go outside during the day and play softball with a stick that we had gotten out of the woods and a rubber ball. And we'd, you hit the ball and you'd run to first base, second base, third base, and home. And what's wrong with that picture? We were running the bases backwards because we didn't know, And so
Didn't
my,
know.
so I moved in with my mom when I was 12 years old. She lived in the park, right? I was a suburb of Chicago. Which I was telling Joe earlier, Adolph Hirst had lived right down the street from me. So it was like going from this segregated little town in Georgia to Oak Park. It was like the first time I had seen a white person up close. It was like,
Just
whoa.
to clarify for those who don't know, Adolph Herseth is probably the incredibly most premier symphonic first trumpet player like ever. He was the first trumpet player in the Chicago Symphony for years.
And so when I moved up north with my mother, then all of a sudden everything, was opened up. It's like you're going to a school with a chess club and all kinds of sports, track and field, music program. We had 3 orchestras, 2 jazz bands, 3 choirs, a barbershop quartet. That was the music program in this school.
And this is about seventh grade for you, sixth or seventh grade?
That was 7th grade for me. And my mom, being a high school band director, it was just kind of, what instrument do you want to play? So I said, I want to play the clarinet because I had seen somebody on TV playing the clarinet with girls dancing around. So I thought that was cool. So my mom brings home a clarinet and I said, no, mom, I want to play the clarinet. She goes, this is a clarinet. I was like, no, that's. So then she showed me the pictures and I picked the trumpet because that's what I actually wanted to play, But, I'd never seen instruments. I mean, back then there were only, especially in Georgia, there were only 3 channels on the TV. So, you never saw, I never saw, like, I remember seeing the Boston Pops with Arthur Fiedler, in Chicago. That was the first time I had, seen something like that. You didn't get any of that in this little town in Georgia.
Well, you entered a whole new world, man. That must have been
I
something.
entered a whole new world. I mean, culture shock, like, you know, wow. So and I immediately, for whatever, you know, I was pretty good at music, and my mom never had to tell me to practice. She'd have to tell me to stop, you know. So I knew at an early age that I wanted to be a musician. And then when I was 16 or 17, they had this solo competition for high school kids for Chicago Symphony, and I went down and won. So I got to play with the orchestra one piece, and then sit in the section and listen to them for one piece, and study with Mr. Herseth. Mm-hmm. And at the first rehearsal, hearing that orchestra, I was like, okay, this is what I want to do.
Yeah.
Well, that's like the best thing any trumpet player could possibly ask for. That's like golden opportunity.
Yeah, in Chicago back then, I mean, was so great, because you had the cool jazz festival in the summertime, and that's where I first saw Miles Davis play live, you know, and that blew my mind, you know. I saw Freddie Hubbard play live, you know, and then being able to, my mom would take me to see Chicago Symphony concerts all the time, and then in the summer, get a chance to go to Ravinia, you know, I mean, there was no better place for a brass player, especially a trumpet player, to grow up than Chicago back then, because Chicago really isn't that large of a town like New York. It's really small. I mean, downtown Chicago is like, what, 1 mile, 3/4 of a mile, you know, long. So everything, the Lyric Opera and the ballet, Hubbard Street, dancers, they're all kind of packed into this one little area. So, you know, you can go around and see a lot of different kinds of music. I mean, Joe Siegel's Jazz Showcase, you know, was down there.
So that goes to your, you know, your wide, various abilities in all kinds of genres of music.
Yeah. I mean, my mom, you know, was totally into classical music, not really that much into jazz. So that's pretty much all that I saw, you know, which is why I wanted to be a classical musician. And it wasn't until I got to Eastman that I got really interested in jazz, you know, although I really wasn't serious about it. I wanted to be an orchestral trumpet player, you know, and it wasn't until I graduated college and started to work, you know, because you find out the hard way when you graduate that, like, okay, I'm not as good as I thought I was, and it's going to take some time for me to, you know, get something going. So for me, I started playing on the commercial side of things. When I graduated Eastman, I went and worked on a cruise ship, which I think is the best gig that a young trumpet player can do, because, you know, all of a sudden, you know, you're playing all of these swing tunes, and you're getting experience playing commercial music like Gloria Estefan, and you're playing behind the jugglers and the comedians. So you're playing like R&B, jazz, classical, you know, Latin, you know, every style, you know, and that really prepared me for moving to New York.
And I'm imagining on a cruise ship, that's pretty intimate too. I mean, you have a consistent audience, so you've got to really connect with the people there, and you're enjoying themselves.
Yeah.
Well, it's a new audience every week, so, but
exactly. I'm sure I was on every 4 days.
You're playing new stuff every day.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
Or every week at least.
Yeah.
Because they bring in new entertainment from time to time, right?
Oh, sure, man. I mean, I remember my first night on the ship. I came to find out later that the saxophone player was on the Dorsey band, and the trombone player that was in the band had just gotten off the Buddy Rich band. So here comes me, this orchestral C trumpet guy from Eastman, you know, and we sit down, and the first tune they call for the dance set was Giant Steps. You know, because there was nobody in the room. We had just sailed, so they were just jamming. And I just kind of sat there like, oh no, you know, what is this? So at the end of the night, the band leader comes up to me and he goes, Man, you can really play the trumpet, man. You sight read the show really well. He goes, I should fire you because you're not a jazz player and you got to be a jazz player to be out here. But if you promise me you'll learn, I'll keep you on. And I ended up studying with that guy every week. He'd give me solos to transcribe and I transcribed the solos. And just by, just being thrown into the fire at these dance sets because, I'm flipping through the real book and these guys know the tunes from memory. So by the time, I can dig up in your own sweet way, they're already halfway done with the tune. So that was
Right.
like,
Well,
wow.
you know what? Let's get a taste of some of your jazz playing. I've got another little video here, and let's see if we can put this up. Right, this should do it. I think that was looks like it was recorded on a phone or something, so the sound wasn't that great. But
Probably
you get the
that was
idea.
in, I don't know where that video came from. We were in Brazil
So Butch Miles, right?
with a Butch Miles Jazz Express big band. Yeah, some heavy players on that gig. The story, the backstory for me with that tune was I was with a Basie band and we were in Vienne, France. And we were doing the Vienne Jazz Festival with Frank West as the guest artist. So it was a live TV broadcast that night. So we rehearsed with Mr. West that afternoon. And I went back to the hotel to take a nap, and the phone rings. And I answer the phone, and it's Frank West. He's like, "Hey, you know the Midgets?" I said, "Yes, sir, I do. We're gonna play that one tonight." And he hung up the phone. And I'm like, okay. And that was, wow. I couldn't believe it. I mean, it went off really well. I wasn't nervous or anything. I guess I just didn't have time to get nervous or whatever, but it's like, wow, man, I'm standing here with Frank West, man. That's pretty incredible.
Hot dog. Yeah. Hey, Warren, you want to say hello? Warren Vacher is in the house, ladies and gentlemen. And
one of my heroes, man.
Take easy, Sean. You're one of mine. You are one of the finest musicians I've ever worked with.
Man, Warren, thanks. Man, coming from you, that means so much.
And it's probably because Frank West had at us both. You didn't get away with much with Frank. Great to see you. Listen, stay healthy, will you? I hope to see you soon.
Yeah, thanks, Warren. I hope to see you too, man. I a little story, man. I remember the last time I played with you was probably with Mooch. And so you pass me this tune and you go, hey, man, why don't you play this one? And I said, okay, fine. He goes, oh, there's a high note in there, man. I don't want to deal with it. And I was like, okay, fine. So the next tune, you played a solo and you started your solo on a double G, man. And the whole trumpet section just fell on the floor. And you come back and I was like, you mean you can't play high notes, man? I can't do that.
I can't play them on demand. I can start with them, but I can't finish with them.
Oh, man. Warren, man, whew, you're the baddest. No joke, man.
Yeah, both of you guys were in the...
I think that's one. Did you know Bobby Lewis? Did you ever meet Bobby in Chicago?
I knew who he was. I never met him because I was a little kid and I couldn't get into the bars, you know. So, you know, when I was in Chicago, I mean, I left when I was 18, so I never got really a chance to hear him live.
You'd have loved him. He was another one of those all-around great guys, great players.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, both of these guys were in the Red Bank Jazz Orchestra, and, you know, I wish I had a clip up that I could play for you, but I couldn't put it together in time.
There's a picture that you showed of us at the beginning. It's like John Faddis is playing the fourth trumpet chair.
Right.
Actually, he jumped up there when Warren went down front to play a feature.
That's right.
So John played fourth trumpet, but while Warren played a solo, man.
Yeah, yeah. The story there was I asked John to play this feature, and John said, you got Warren in the band, let Warren play it. So I said, well, if Warren's going to play the solo, then you got to go sit in the band on fourth. So that's what he did.
I show everybody that picture, man. It's just like, man, you never know who you end up sitting next to in New York City in a trumpet section. It's like you've always got to bring your A game.
Yeah. There's another one of you in there, I think, with Lou Soloff. I think that was also on my gig.
Yeah. And the funny story about Lou, when I was at Eastman, I think I was like 19, he came and gave a masterclass. And he was the first person to really talk the business side of music to me, well, to all of us, but he said, you know, you have to be nice to everybody you meet because you're not gonna know who you're gonna end up playing with one day that you might have dissed 20 years ago or whatever. And he said, you know, also it's important to bring your A game because he said, you know, you're all students now, but when you move to New York, I'm your competition. You know, and as a 19-year-old kid, I was like, yeah, right, whatever. And I remember when I first moved to New York, Brian Pareschi, great trumpet player, I subbed for him all over the place. And he called me to play at the World Trade Centers between the Twin Towers. They had a Sunday night jazz series with David Berger's band. So I go my first day and I think I was playing third trumpet. So I get there early and I sit down and set up all of my stuff. And I kind of side eye, see somebody walking past me. Guess who it was? Lou Soloff comes in, sits down right next to me on the lead book. So it's like 20 years later, and it's like, oh man, this guy was right. You know, it's like,
who was it? Somebody, one of the musicians, a monk or somebody, said, be nice to the people when you're on your way up because you're going to meet them again when you're on your way down.
Yeah. Dig, man. Yeah, no doubt, man. No doubt.
So somebody mentioned the Broadway shows that you were playing, and I have another clip I want to get in here because I think this is fascinating, and I think our audience will appreciate it too. This is the what the life of a guy playing in the pit on Broadway is about. All right, so let me cue that up. So that's what it's like being in a pit playing a Broadway show.
Where are you getting these clips from? These are some very unique clips.
Story behind that. I mean, that was obviously on my phone. That was 2012. I was doing Nice Work If You Can Get It with Matthew. But trumpet section, I got on that gig because, and later on, but Bob Milliken said he would only do the job if he could hire his own trumpet section. So he hired myself and Brian Pereschi. That was an incredible trumpet section. And I mean, to play with Bob Milliken every night, And so Bob, that clip was taken. Bob was actually, he took a leave to go play with Barbara Streisand. And I moved up to play the lead trumpet book. So I was always constantly, you know, trying to, you know, do justice to the way he plays, you know what I mean? And so I'd record myself quite often and, you know, take it home and analyze it. And that's just basically what I was doing there, you know?
And are these posted publicly or did you send these to Joe?
You know, I happened to put that on my YouTube page, I think it was.
I found it on YouTube.
Wow.
I didn't do it. You know, I'm a technological idiot. So, you know, I didn't intend for that to be public, but it is, you know. But,
well, yeah. You know, I just thought for our audiences, they don't really usually get to see that side of it. You know, you sit in the audience on a Broadway show and you don't really realize what's going on down below the stage there in this dark, smelly, dusty room, right, with all the musicians. And they're pumping it out, man.
And the
sound is weird because all you hear is like you and some of the trumpets and like that.
Yeah. I mean, the difficult part about that is like having a show with Bob Milliken, you know, he'll decide at like 3 o'clock in the afternoon during the matinee. I mean, you're sitting next to him and he'll lean over to you and go, I mean, I can't, I'm not going to imitate Bob Milliken. That's, but you know, Bob, that laugh that he's got, you know, he'll do that. Yeah. We'll go, I don't think I want to be here. You're going to play lead tonight, you know, and he'll get up and walk out and like on a couple of hours notice, you know, and you've got to jump up and play his book. Cause I was the third trumpet player for that show, you know, and, you know, just damn glad to be there. I mean, hearing Bob play lead every night was just amazing. And the second trumpet book that, you know, I was expected to play, Brian Pareschi, who's master plunger, mute, and pixie player, you know, and I had to move over and play that part when he wasn't there, you know. So that was a great trumpet section. It really was. But it
sure was.
Yeah. And that show was great because, you know, not normally do you get to play a swing book like that. There was a lot of improv in the show. And a lot of, like, as you can hear, like meaty swing, old school style lead trumpet playing, where, cause you know, it's, if you play vibrato like that in a big band now, you know, the rest of the guys will laugh at you, but you know, that is what I like playing. You know, I'm definitely a pre 1964 jazz guy, you know, that old school, man, that's what I love, man. You know, the vibrato, the big sound, all of that.
As far as I'm concerned, that there was your doctorate, you know, that experience.
It was, I mean, no doubt for me, definitely.
So we have a comment from Barbara who says, Pitt musical players have to be perfect, have to hit every mark, and it was magnificent. So that's from Barbara. And then Diane wants to know, she has a question. She wants to know, gonna switch gears a little bit. She wants to know, what was it like to work with Aretha Franklin and Bette Midler? So if you could tell us a little bit about when you work with them and what that was like.
Yeah, I worked with Bette Midler twice. Once, I think it was, Radio City Music Hall maybe. Oh man. I mean, that was 1999 maybe. Yeah, I mean, she's always perfect and great, you know, and she's a perfectionist. And then I worked with her on her Broadway show that she did a few years ago, Hello Dolly. But I was not a regular, I was a substitute. And, you know, she came in and immediately just started, hope I'm not, I can say this, you just started busting balls, you know. It's like the drummer gotta go and got Buddy Williams, you know. And she's just like, you know, what is this, two trumpets, man? She's like, no, three trumpets, you know. You need that sound, you know. What is this, two trombones thing? No, you need a bigger section. You need that big. And so, you know, they got it together and changed everything for her. And, you know, it made the show that much better, you know, because she came in and demanded, like, you know, the musical considerations that she did, you know, because he needed that big old school sound, you know, that you can't get from a scaled down orchestra, which is what they're trying to do today.
Well, yeah, not here.
What they're doing, you know. Aretha was probably one of the most interesting musical experiences I've ever had. Because
were you with Pretty Purdy?
He wasn't on those jobs. No.
Oh.
He was not on those jobs. Is it H.B. Barnum, I think, was the her MD at that time. But we would rehearse in the afternoons, and we wouldn't rehearse her whole book. You know, we would just kind of hit sections, and then because we didn't know at night what she was going to do. You know, she could decide that she wanted to do 16 bars of a tune and move on, you know. And this is the sad part of the business, but, you know, we would be on stage like waiting and waiting and waiting for the show to start, you know, and you're just kind of staring at the audience, you know. And a guy would walk out from backstage with a duffel bag, and yep. He put a duffel bag underneath the piano, and that was the cue to start the show. Well, Joe could probably tell us what was in the duffel
bag. She would not come out on stage.
That was cash.
She would not come out on stage unless there was 50 large in cash under the piano.
Yeah.
Under the piano. Under the piano.
She wanted to see it. She wanted to make sure it was there. Because, you know, obviously she got burned so many times over the years.
Yeah. You know, and you're playing with Aretha Franklin. It's just like, wow. And, you know, and you know, you got stars in your eyes, and then you're seeing this, and you're like, wow, this is bizarre, you know. But, I mean, great musical experience. I mean, her band was just incredible. And, you know, one of the things that's hard to be a freelance musician in New York was like, okay, you come in the afternoon as the horn section and you rehearse her music and you hit that night. You know what I mean? It's like, if you're not a good sight reader, if you're not easily adaptable, you know. And when I first started doing the job, the trumpet section was Joe Mazzello on lead, Earl Gardner, and Ravi Best, and I would sub for either Ravi or Earl. And then Earl kind of faded away from it. Ravi got a gig, I think, with Little Steven. So all of a sudden, whenever she'd come to New York, I was her lead trumpet player. And apparently the last gig that she ever did, it was like a Carnegie Hall thing here in New York, like 5 or 6 months before she died, but apparently it was her last gig. So I was her last lead trumpet player, you know, little trivia.
Well, thank you for sharing that with us. Unfortunately, she was on my bucket list to see, and I didn't make it, and I would have had the chance to listen to you play and wouldn't have even known. Yeah. Well, I want to we have a little bit more time left. And so I just want to, thank you for being with us tonight. This has been very, very informative and fun, and just love your expansive career. Just want to say thank you for supporting us tonight here at Jazz Arts Project. As you all know, we have been doing this. We passed our year anniversary doing Mondays with Mooch. We are actually, when we started Mondays with Mooch, we were just beginning a pandemic and didn't know what the heck was going on. We did not have opening films. We did not know about Joe's great film auteur capabilities. And we were kind of figuring out this whole Zoom thing. And now we are pretty well adept at Zoom. We've got a pretty amazing catalog of shows that you can go back and look at on YouTube, which are available. And we have a committed audience who comes and spends time with us. So we want to thank you all so much for joining us and supporting us. And things are moving forward. Joe is working. We are hoping. We have plans to do Jazz in the Park. We're working on that. Recruitment is happening for Jazz Arts Academy. And plans are happening for the middle school summer camp, and summer is just around the corner. So in order to do these great things, we need your support. And of course, you can give your support to us at jazzartsproject.org/give. We welcome any support, no dollar is too small. And for many of you who have been supporting us and consistently supporting us, thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you, Carmen. I do have to give out a shout out to some of our sponsors. First of all, to all our supporters, we do appreciate the donations that come in, very much so. We appreciate our sponsors. This year and last year, Ocean First Bank has been very kind to us, so we appreciate that for sure, as well as Mammoth Arts. This program is made possible in part by funds from Mammoth Arts, a partner of the New Jersey State Council on the Arts and the Mammoth County Board of County Commissioners.
And we should just give a nice thank you to Warren Vache, who helped us with our second online fundraiser. So thank you, Warren. That was a lot of fun.
That's right. We had a live stream with Warren and his group, and everybody loved it. And, you know, it was a good time was had by all. Thank you, Warren.
You're very welcome. And thanks to Dan and Renee DeSero.
Dan's here.
Dan is here.
So, hey, Warren, I'm loving your CDs, listening to your music all the time.
Glad you got them, Dan. Thanks again for your hospitality.
So I'm going to ask a very silly question, Shawn, and you can reprimand me or do whatever you want to say, but I have to ask. So there's a popular Edmonds in the industry by the name of Kenneth Edmonds. And of course, I've been looking online trying to see, are there any relation? And if you don't know who Kenneth Edmonds is, Kenneth Edmonds is a musician, producer, known in the industry as Babyface. So he's a big R&B artist. And I don't see the name Edmonds very often. So of course I was looking online, but I didn't find any connection. So I didn't think so.
Yeah, I wish, man, that would be so nice.
Shawn, so Dr. Babyface.
But you do have a baby face, Shawn, though. I will say you do have a nice baby face. So.
somebody said.
Question for Joe.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Joe, we don't see you.
Red Bank Jazz Orchestra.
Oh, wait. Why don't we see me?
I don't know.
Oh, I got to do this. There we go.
I have a question for Joe.
Yeah.
Red Bank Jazz Orchestra, man. When are we going to get back to it?
Aye. That's a good question. When the theaters open up, maybe. You know, I've got some outdoor stuff in the works, but you know, budgets are not easy to come by for a whole big band.
Yeah.
But it's on my mind, believe me. I miss that more than anything.
Yeah.
Somebody said early on in the questions, what was it? Oh, now I can't find it. Ah.
Well, can you remember it?
I think it was Lynn Mueller. I forget what she said, but
you talked about midget.
I thought it was interesting. Lynn, are you still here? Why don't you unmute yourself and join us. Lynn is not here.
I'm here.
There she is.
Hi there. So my question was, Aretha performed at Radio City Music Hall. Were you in the band?
I think I was.
Probably her last performance at Radio City at that point.
Yeah, it was within the last 3 years of her death, I was, because by that time, Earl Gardner was not doing it anymore, and I was in for him.
And I think Whitney Houston had just died then.
Wow.
Right then. So do you remember that?
I remember when Whitney died a while ago, though, didn't she?
I think it was 2012.
Right.
2012, I think Whitney passed.
That would have been right, yeah.
Okay, 2012, I don't think I was playing Aretha by that point. When did Aretha die? Because I remember doing 3 years with her.
Everybody run to the Google machine.
Right, I'm not getting to go. I'm not sure.
I want to say 2 years ago. Let's see if I'm
2018,
right.
2018, it says.
Yeah. I'm right. Well, 3 years ago.
it was 2012, I don't think I would have been on that. But she was here so much.
Right. You would have remembered that night, I think. It was pretty amazing. It was difficult for her, I think.
Did you play her in Red Bank? Down here?
No, that was... Basie? No.
Radio City.
I think she did play the
musical. She was here at the Basie at some point.
I saw her at the State Theater. That's where I saw her.
Yeah, it's the part of the circuit.
So when you get your doctorate, what are you planning to do with your doctorate after, once you have that in hand?
To be honest with you, I'm hoping that I never have to use it, only because I want to keep what I'm doing now. I mean, for me, basically when the market crashed in 2008, that hit me hard. I lost half of my jobs overnight. I was playing in the West End Symphony here in New York City, and that orchestra folded. Some wedding jobs that I was doing folded. So I went back to school to get a master's degree at Lehman. And halfway through that, things came back. So I dropped out of school. And that's when I started. The reason I dropped out of school is because of that Broadway pit job that you saw. So I started doing that and never really went back. And then about 8 years ago, I was doing a master class at, where it's really cold. North Dakota. There's a university, I think it's in Bismarck. And I was there with Conrad Herwig, who's the chair at Rutgers. And just something said to me, you know, why don't you ask this guy, man, about the jazz program there and going back to school? And he was like, oh yeah, we'd love to have you, man. You know, send me a copy of your diploma. And, you know, and so that's when I went back to school. And it was just basically, well, as a safety net, because, you know, the music business is a gamble. You know, I've been involved in Broadway since 1998, but I've subbed on shows like Chicago, which is still running after 22 years. But I also subbed at Scottsboro Boys that lasted 6 weeks. Mm. You know, so you're gambling with your future when you're a freelance musician, such as myself. You know,
not because to mention Broadway's been dark for now. It's going to be a year and a half.
Yeah, I mean, you got to realize I've only had three jobs my whole life. Count Basie was my chair. The cruise ship was my chair. Nice Work, If You Can Get It, was my chair. The pit job you just saw, and Ain't Too Proud, the show I'm doing now, was my job. I've only had four jobs my whole life. Everything else has been substituting and playing for people who came through town. So, you know, you can imagine what it's like, you know, trying to have a mortgage and car payments and insurance during that, because it's so up and down. You know, one week you'll make $2,000 and the next week you'll make $250, you know. So having a safety net is, I think, is important. And that's why I went back I'm 56 years old now. So, you know, that's why I went back to school, just to make sure that, you know, I retire without, you know, because with me, all I can do is play the trumpet. You know, I've never done anything else. So it's like, if I don't get a doctorate, I'm going to be, I mean, not that there's anything wrong with it, but I'm going to be working down at the Costco or driving Uber, you know? So that's what I did it to be honest.
The real life of a musician.
Yeah, but in reality, soon he's going to be back.
Sorry, Joe, to interrupt you. If you told me that at 56 years old, I would not be playing in a top 12 major symphony in the United States, I would have wanted to fight you, because I wanted so badly to play in Chicago Symphony or New York Phil or Dallas, you know, and I never got there, you know. So I did the next best thing for myself, which is to become a commercial trumpet player, you know. And, you know, it's like your dreams don't always come true, but then you sideline and you get to do something else that you like just as much, you know. So you know, that was my career. It was like, you know, I didn't really realize my dream. Not that I'm mad about that, but you never know what you're going to end up doing, you know, which is why I always tell students, you know, it's just like, you got to be well-rounded. You know, it's like if all you can do is play C trumpet and play symphony fantastique and orchestra, man, there's only 48 guys in the United States doing that. I mean, there's 4 trumpets in an orchestra and there's 12 major orchestras. It's 48 trumpet players, right? You know, come on. That's a wow. You got a better chance of making the NBA than getting a symphony job.
And probably 48,000 vying for those jobs.
Yeah.
Big, and they're all really good, you know.
We have one other question in the chat. Lynn wants to know, do you have your own band?
Yes and no. I did briefly, but it's so hard to get, you know, guys show up on time, and then you're dealing with, you know, the money thing, trying to play jazz. So it's, for me, it's easy just to be a side man and show up and play, than to have to worry about all the other stuff.
Well, I think your worries are unfounded. Soon enough, you'll be back playing Broadway and touring and all those stuff. And I'm sure you're going to be making all the guys in the section call you doctor.
Can you imagine leaning over to Bob Milliken and saying that?
And they will be razzing you about it for sure.
They will never find out unless you tell them.
Oh, I'm going to tell them.
And I have to say that with the way things were this weekend, I actually, driving around, I had to drive to Freehold, but I didn't go on the parkway, thank goodness, but going around it. But I feel people are ready to come back because the Garden State Parkway was bagged up like crazy. So people were heading to the beach. So people are definitely raring to go and kind of get out and do some things. So I think,
you know what, that's true. However, as Sean was saying, as a freelance musician, that doesn't necessarily mean that wages are going to be back to what they were. You know, are people going to hire musicians at the rates that we had gotten to back then? You know, what's our economic concerns gonna affect this? You know, maybe they're gonna expect people are gonna be begging for work, perhaps, to get back to it, and maybe, you know, everybody's gonna start accepting less. So it's gonna be hard. It could be harder for a good long while on musicians returning back to the fold.
Yeah. Well, look at what's happening with the Metropolitan Opera Orchestra. I mean, they're right now, it looks like they might even close up shop. I mean, they're going through management, major management issues. And then, you know, they're having trouble with all parties concerned coming to the table to negotiate because they want to pay them 30% less for life, you know. And, what? And
then, yeah, there's going to have to be a lot of decisions made. You know, am I going to accept that kind of pay cut, or am I going to look somewhere else?
Yeah. No.
And it'll trickle down to the one-off gigs too. You know, it'll be, you know, the clubs maybe will start paying. You know, they won't pay $50 anymore. They'll pay $25 now. How ridiculous is that?
Yeah. Well, Joe, you notice I'm not laughing at that one.
I know. Sorry about that.
A funny story about that is one of the places, it's a dance club called Swing 46 in the middle of Midtown. And when I first moved to town, I was playing there a lot with his drummer, Steve Little. I don't know if you know Steve, he's had a great career. I mean, he did Sesame Street for a long time, so he had a nice pension. But he was saying to me one night on the break, he goes, you know, it's 1997. He goes, back in 1978, I played the same club for the same money that we're making tonight.
Dig that.
And that knocked me off my feet. Wow. Right.
Yeah. And they're probably still paying the same money. Yeah. Well, maybe that doctorate is kind of a smart move. At least You know, you can still, especially with a music position as a professor in a college, you can still have a playing career. Yeah. In fact, they encourage that.
Right. Because
it keeps you in vogue, essentially.
Sure.
And are better able to bring that concepts to your students as well.
I mean, for me, I've always wanted to teach because, I mean, there have been so many people in my past who have sat down with me, you know, who shouldn't even have given me the time of day and talked to me about trumpet playing and embouchure and everything for free. I mean, Byron Stripling was the first guy to do that. John Faddis, you know, and I learned so much from other players that I didn't even pay for advice. So I feel like, you know, I have a lot of information that I got for free that I would like to impart, you know, onto the students, you know, like a lot of things that they don't teach you in school, because my playing didn't get better by leaps and bounds until I started meeting commercial guys in town and talking about, you know, things like endurance and strength and, you know, things that you just don't talk about if you study with a classical teacher. You know, I mean, right. Wynton Marsalis he stands in the corner for an hour and plays a G in the staff for an hour every day. And it's like, I started doing that and almost overnight, my playing got better because of the focus and the strength. And I was like, wow, who knew? But, you know, you're not going to learn that getting a classical degree, you know?
Well, short of like Penzarella, there's a few guys.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, listen, we are getting sort of overtime here. It was fabulous having you. And I'll give you a call because we got some other things to chat about off air. What generally happens at this point is we wrap it up and thank everybody. Mm-hmm. And we turn off the recording and we turn off the Facebook feed and we have what's known as an after gig hang. So anyone wants to hang out and chat a little bit, you're welcome too. But we're going to thank Shawn at this point. So you can unmute yourself and give Shawn a round of applause if you will. And I'll start it off with this. And then maybe this. Shawn, it was great. Thank you.
Thanks, Joe. Appreciate it, man.
Thank you, everyone, for coming by and hanging with us. I'm glad you're on the mend. And you'll be out and about in no time. So I have one more thing to do. And I can sign off officially with this. Thank you, guys.
Thank you very much.